Hi, welcome. It's my great privilege to welcome all of you to the Dreyfous Lecture on Civil Liberties and Human Rights. The Dreyfous Lecture, as many of you know, is the oldest and one of the most distinguished endowed lectures at Tulane Law School. It is dedicated to the memory of two persons of enormous conviction, vision, and courage, George and Mathilde Schwab Dreyfous. The values that they held dear, free speech, racial equality, justice, fair play, of course, should be utterly unremarkable in America. But the reality, of course, is that George and Mathilde Dreyfous fought openly and valiantly for those values at times and places that made what they did remarkable indeed. In the dark days of the Great Depression, as the anxieties of war were swirling and suspicions of disloyalty fell all too easily, George founded the Louisiana League for the Preservation of Constitutional Rights and fearlessly stood up for victims of political persecution and police brutality, many of them persons of color. 20 years later, with his beloved wife Mathilde, he founded Louisiana's affiliate of the ACLU at the height of the McCarthy era. And together they fought unflinchingly for racial justice, desegregation, and freedom of conscience. Mathilde, in her own right, led the fight for good government as president of New Orleans chapter of the League of Women Voters. They were driven by a powerful sense of right that led them to risk their own welfare, fortune, and personal safety. In 1960, when Ruby Bridges braved a mob to enter the William France Elementary School, she was accompanied not only by the U.S. Marshals famously depicted in the iconic Norman Rockwell painting, but also by the Dreyfuses. George volunteered to walk the gauntlet with her. Mathilde ferried children to school in her car, her license plate recorded and reported in the newspapers. When the state legislature cut off funds to pay teachers' salaries in integrated schools, the Dreyfuses secretly fronted $16,000 to pay the back wages of 55 teachers and staff to keep the schools going. In the 1950s, racial injustice was, as Norman Rockwell titled his painting of Bridges, the problem we all live with. For George and Mathilde Dreyfous, it was the problem they did something about. After George's passing in 1961, Mathilde and her sons generously endowed this lecture series devoted to the cause of civil liberties in his honor. In 2003, the lecture series was renamed to honor her as well, recognizing their common cause and sacrifice. Today, we are deeply honored to welcome today's distinguished Dreyfous lecturer, Professor Ian Haney López. Before turning over the podium to Professor Jancy Hofel to introduce Professor Haney López, let me take this opportunity to express our enormous gratitude to the enormous and abiding support of the Dreyfous Schwab family, several of whom are here with us today. You make this occasion so special you make it possible in the first instance, but also so special by your continued presence and support on this occasion. So thank you so much on behalf of Tulane. With that, I'll now turn the podium over to Professor Hofel.
Thank you, Dean Meyer. I am super stoked about this lecture. So I can and will stand here and introduce Professor Ian Haney López by traditional means because it's fitting to celebrate his stunning credentials and achievements. But I want to say right up front that to me his most impressive creds are in his persistent, provocative, and powerful press of his claims about the construction of racism in his books, in his speeches, and in the media. He gets out there and he gets heard. Never has there been a better time to challenge ourselves to think about what he has to say about the enduring linkage between politics, race, and the economy. But first, Professor Haney López is the John H. Bolt Professor of Law at the Berkeley School of Law, where he teaches in the areas of race and constitutional law. He is widely known. It's always said he's widely known as one of the greatest thinkers, and I want to put influential and original thinkers because he doesn't just think. He actually does something about it. He goes out there and does something about it. But he's widely known as one of the most influential and original thinkers on racism's evolution in the United States since the Civil Rights era. He's been a visiting law professor at Yale, NYU, and Harvard, and holds a master's in history from Washington University and a master's in public policy from Princeton. In 2011, he received an Alphonse Fletcher Fellowship awarded to scholars whose work further the integration goals of Brown versus Board of Education. Professor Haney López is the author of three books, White by Law, The Legal Construction of Race, Racism on Trial, The Chicano Fight for Justice, and most recently, Dog Whistle Politics, How Coded Racial Appeals Have Reinvented Racism and Wrecked the Middle Class. As my good friend Saru Matambananzo tells me, all three books, because I've only read the last one, all three books have broken new ground on discussion of race and started new discussions on the structure of race. He has an impressive cadre of scholarly articles published in venues like Yale Law Journal and NYU and Stanford Law Reviews. But to me, again, even more meaningful, in order to make a difference in the world, Professor Haney López has just as many blog posts and op-eds and media appearances on MSNBC, CNN, C-SPAN, and CNN with people like Melissa Harris-Perry. Who's she? Larry King and Moyers and Company, among others. Currently, the media seeks his views, and he talks about the cause and effects of the racial pandering of all of the presidential candidates. This book right here, this makes me feel like, you know, Jon Stewart. not that I'm liberal. But even if I am liberal, I am still subject to dog whistling, as he can explain to you better than me. Dog Whistle Politics, copies of which will be available after the lecture, and Professor Haney López will be on hand to sign yours. So well written and thoroughly supported, it gripped me. I don't want to say too much about it because I'm guessing it will illuminate his talk here today, and better from him than from me. But suffice it to say, it executes its theme brilliantly, providing a powerful linkage between what you will learn as dog whistle politics of candidates and the lulling devastation of the middle class who vote for those candidates. This is a new, provocative, and critical thesis that deserves all of the attention and reaction, for better or for worse, that it's going to get and that it has been getting. In this lecture, entitled Trump-itting Racism, Race, Politics, and Economic Jeopardy for All, Ian Haney López is going to help us understand that Donald Trump, a seeming outlier in his unbelievable and audible proclamations, is following the basic script of conservatives in the United States for the last 50 years. The use of racial and other status anxieties to scare voters into supporting politicians who ultimately enact policies that benefit the rich. So it is my absolute pleasure to introduce our 2016 Dreyfous lecturer, Professor Ian Haney López.
Good afternoon, all. How are you all doing? Good. All right. Thank you all. I appreciate it. Thank you very much for the warm welcome here at Tulane. By way of prefatory remark, it really is an honor to give the Dreyfous Lecture. The Dreyfous Lecture is coming out of a time of broad social mobilization. We think of it in terms of the civil rights movement as a time of broad social mobilization around race. But if you think about the basic demand of race was for inclusion in civic society, which included the right to a decent wage, the right to homes, to housing, to schools, to many of the governmental programs that then existed. This was always, I think, a movement about race and class, never more so than in its expression. Ultimately in the Poor People's Campaign that Martin Luther King was organizing. And I want to say that in that sense, the Dreyfous Lecture is never more timely than it is again in 2016 and in the years that will come, because we are, I hope, indeed, I would say it more strongly, we must be, if we are to survive as a democracy, on the cusp of another period of broad mobilization, starting with Occupy Wall Street, including Black Lives Matter, another period of broad mobilization around race and class. And so it's a really a distinct honor to be able to give the Dreyfous Lecture. Thank you so much to the family. Now, obviously, I'm going to talk about Donald Trump. Let me, just in case any of you have to leave in 1 minute, let me lay out what I'm going to say. Listen, most talks about race are talks that say we should really pay attention to what's going on with communities of color because things are bad, and we are morally obligated as a society to focus on that and to remediate it. And I agree with that, and I've been saying that for 20 years. Now, but this talk is going to say something different. This talk is going to say we have to pay attention to race because race is structuring our economy and jeopardizing the well-being of the 99%. Race matters to everybody. And here, let me just be totally frank. In the 1960s and the 1950s, as the civil rights movement gathered steam, whites could comfortably and accurately say to themselves, whatever, race works for me, right? And I think most did. They can no longer say that in 2016. Whites are no longer in a position of being able to say privately, race works for us. Black Lives Matter, the immigrants' rights marches, whatever's going on in our cities, it's not about me. It is about you. It's about what's happening to our economy. It's about how power is shifting to corporations and to wealthy familial dynasties. It is about you. And so what I really want to push is a paradigm shift that says it's time for all of us to talk about race, not as bad things that happen to people of color, but as a tool of the very rich that hurts all of us. Right? And just one point of clarification, I do not mean to displace attention from people of color. I actually think by shifting to understand how race serves as a tool for the very rich, we come to understand the central dynamics that have so devastated minority communities over the last 50 years, including mass incarceration of the sort that Michelle Anderson writes about, Michelle Alexander writes about, and including mass deportation. Right? But I think we need to shift to thinking about race not as things that we do to people of color, but as race as a weapon being used by the very rich. And who better to exemplify that than Donald Trump?
The U.S. has become a dumping ground for everybody else's problems. Thank you. When Mexico sends its people, they're not sending their best. They're not sending you. They're not sending you. They're sending people that have lots of problems, and they're bringing those problems with us. They're bringing drugs, they're bringing crime, they're rapists, and some, I assume, are good people.
So I always quote that last line to my wife, because she's Mexican, and I always say, and some, I assume, are good people. So this is craziness, right? And little did we know when Trump launched his presidential campaign that this was mild Trump. This was reasonable Trump. All he's saying is that they're rapists. He's not saying ban all of them. He's just saying build a wall. It's a beautiful wall, right? But you know, and he's not inviting violence. So, okay. People are responding to Trump right now by debating whether he's an immigrant-bashing carnival barker or a fascist demagogue. And I want to say yes, right? He's both, okay? But I also want to say we actually lose something when we start to think about Donald Trump as an outlier. Because in fact, his success is based upon what has been happening on the right in terms of political discourse. Many people say, Donald Brazil just said today, for the last 8 years since President Obama's inauguration, but really it's the last 50 years. And so I'm going to make two claims about dog whistle politics. One claim is that this is all about race. It's about coded racism, right? And that's the dog whistle metaphor. The metaphor there is something that is silent on one level but triggers strong racial reactions on the other. And so think about terms like inner city, welfare queen, illegal alien, thug. On one level, those words don't have anything to do with race, but on another, think of the faces that are associated with it. Or think about phrases like silent majority, heartland, homeland, real Americans, hardworking taxpayers, make America great again. Again, no reference to race, and yet strong racial connotations. Now, does Donald Trump speak in dog whistles? I think many of you will say no. He's just a blatant out-and-out racist. I'll come back to that at the end of my talk. I'll pick up on that again, because I actually think that there's an important way in which he is still dog whistling. So I'll come back to that. That's one half of dog whistling. And I want to tell you, a lot of people say, okay, there's dog whistle politics. You know, they used to call it the Southern strategy. It occurs on the margins, blah, 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 blah. I actually want to say, the use of coded racial appeals is not marginal. It's instrumental to conservative politics. But much more importantly, it's tied to a particular vision of governance. It's tied to a vision of governance in which the message is fear people of color, hate government, support the market. And how do you best hate government to support the market? Well, you cut taxes, because that cuts support for government. And whose taxes should you cut? The 1%. And so when you actually back away from all of Trump's rhetoric, what is he actually proposing? The only detailed public policy plan he has out there is a tax proposal to cut taxes back to levels we haven't seen since the 1890s. He wants to cut taxes on the rich by another third. Right? And it's the only substantive proposal out there. And I want to say, this is dog whistle politics. It's the combination of two elements: the use of coded racial appeals to build popular support for the policy preferences of the very rich, most notably massive tax cuts. Okay, so this is my theme. This is what I'm going to argue. This is what we've been doing for 50 years. And to make that clear, I want to go back to slightly more than 50 years. I want to go back to Lyndon Johnson. Why Lyndon Johnson? This is the last time a Democratic candidate for president won a majority of the white vote. The last time a Democratic candidate for president won a majority of the white vote. Watch his campaign ad.
Poverty is not a trait of character. It is created anew in each generation, but not by heredity, by circumstances. Today, millions of American families are caught in circumstances beyond their control. Their children will be compelled to live lives of poverty unless the cycle is broken. President Johnson's war on poverty has this one goal: to provide everyone a chance to grow and make his own way. A chance at education. A chance at training. A chance at a fruitful life. For the first time in the history of America, this can be done. Vote for President Johnson on November 3rd. The stakes are too high for you to stay home.
And people did. Right, and I wanna just pause there. You have a Democratic candidate for president who's saying poverty is not a trait of character. It's not a cultural failing. It's a function of circumstance, and we, as the wealthiest country in the world, have the ability and the moral responsibility to end it. In fact, Lyndon Johnson was saying in 1964, we should end poverty by the bicentennial. What greater way to mark 200 years of this country than by ending poverty for everybody? Right? And now, we haven't heard that language in 50 years, but we're hearing it again for the first time from Bernie Sanders. But Sanders is presented by the media as a kook, as someone who's this is sort of pie-in-the-sky fantasy that you could actually talk about things like health care, let alone ending poverty. And yet, look at the landslide. This was a huge landslide in Johnson's favor. And a lot of the sort of political class looked at these results and said, that shows that we are fundamentally a liberal country, a progressive country which believes in the power of activist government to help everybody. Right? And so this is how far, this is what we've lost in 50 years. Right? People looked at this and said, we are fundamentally a liberal country. And yet, there's Louisiana and four other states in the Deep South. And they're voting Republican. And this is a shock. And it's a shock because, as you know, these are the states that had been part of the solid Democratic South, right? A Democratic tradition that loathed, which is probably too weak a word, but loathed the Democrats, or the Republicans, that blamed the Republicans for the war of aggression, more that blamed the Republicans for some of the great moments in the civil rights movement. Earl Warren, the author of Brown versus Board of Education, former Republican governor. When troops come back into the South to enforce desegregation, it's Dwight Eisenhower, Republican president, who sends them. Southern Democrats loathed the Republican Party. And also, this is a moment when they're going to vote for Republican candidate Barry Goldwater, who's promising to dismantle the New Deal. And this is striking because the South, even more than the North, benefited from the New Deal. Indeed, Barry Goldwater is campaigning across the South saying that he's going to break up and sell the Tennessee Valley Authority. The TVA, which had provided electricity for the first time to millions of rural Southern households. So now we have this mystery. We have Democrats voting for the Republican Party that they loathe, and for a candidate who promises to dismantle the New Deal which they support. Why? Because the Republicans had a strategy. This is the only text I'm going to show you. It's critically important. This is Robert Novak walking out of the meeting of the Republican National Committee in 1963 in Denver. And this is what he writes. Right? He's a journalist. This is what he writes. A good many, perhaps a majority of the party's leadership, envision substantial political gold to be mined in the racial crisis by becoming, in fact, though not in name, the white man's party. What is he saying? What is the racial crisis? The civil rights movement. And what he's saying is, this is the Republican leadership looking at the anxiety rising across the country because of the civil rights movement and realizing that they could use race as a wedge issue to break the New Deal coalition of African Americans, the white working and middle class across the country, and progressives across the country, that they can use race as a wedge issue. Now, I want to be clear. This is not racism, not in the sense of bigotry. If in the 1960s there's a white man's party, you know which party that was. It was the Southern Democrats, who had used force and violence and fraud to disenfranchise and exclude African Americans. If there's a white man's party, it is the Southern Democrats. Up until this period, Northern Democrats and the Republican Party were just about equally, if tepidly, committed to civil rights. This is not a story about racism in the Republican Party. This is a story about strategy. Strategy. They look around, they think how they can win, they realize they can use race as a wedge issue, and they make the fateful decision to do so. And one other comment about this quote. This is going to be the white man's party in fact, though not in name. Right? This is a response to the civil rights movement, when you can no longer proclaim yourself expressly in name the party of white people. That had been what the Southern Democrats had been doing. But because of the success of the civil rights movement, express endorsements of white supremacy were more and more seen as immoral and unjust and were broadly repudiated by the American public as a whole. You could no longer stand up and say expressly, I support the interests of white people. But you could say it in code. And this is the shift to dog whistling, the moment when coded racial references become important. And so Barry Goldwater, who's campaigning against Lyndon Johnson, campaigns across the South using two main coded phrases, states' rights and freedom of association. States' rights, now, I think you all have a sense of what states' rights means. I teach con law in California. My students don't so much. right? So I'm teaching con law, and I'm talking to them about federalism and states' rights, and their eyes glaze over, right? And that's just trying to get through an hour-long lecture in con law where they're required to be there. Can you imagine campaigning on federalism? Unless everybody understands states' rights means the right of southern states to resist the federal mandate of integration. And freedom of association. I mean, again, right? I mean, I'm going to campaign based upon John Rawls and individual liberty and political philosophy. Come on! That's not going to work unless people understand that freedom of association means the rights of whites to refuse to associate with blacks. And in particular, the right of white businesses to exclude blacks and of white homeowners to refuse to sell or to rent to blacks. States' rights. Freedom of association. These are the themes that Barry Goldwater campaigns on. And he carries, in addition to his home state of Arizona, which has its own messed up racial dynamics too, the five states in the Deep South with the largest African-American population. And after 1964, it seems clear, or at least a clear warning, that race can be used to convince the most diehard Democrats, the most committed supporters of the New Deal, to switch and to vote for a Republican who promises to dismantle activist government if appealed to on the basis of race. Would it play out? It wasn't clear in 1968. Just wasn't clear. Richard Nixon had his suspicions, but Barry Goldwater had been so badly beaten that it wasn't clear. But by 1970, the number crunchers looked at the results from 64, they looked at the results from 68, and number crunchers on both the Republican and Democratic side said to Richard Nixon, you can do it. You can use race to break that New Deal coalition. You can use race to peel away the white working and middle class from the Democratic Party. And Richard Nixon began in 1970, he shifted politically, and he began a campaign of dog whistle politics. He started talking about states' rights in the South. He started talking about forced busing in the North. Right? Forced busing, as if the issue was putting school children on buses. People have been doing that for decades. When the real issue in the North was putting children on buses in order to integrate schools across jurisdictional lines. Right? Started talking about law and order. Started talking about the silent majority. Right? And now, was he dog whistling? I mean, states' rights, forced busing, law and order, silent majority, where's race? Well, luckily for us, we have Richard Nixon taping himself watching one of his own commercials. And he's watching one of his own commercials on law and order, and he pounds the desk, and he says, that's it. It hits it right on the head. It's all about law and order and the damn Negroes and Puerto Ricans. Right? He knew what he was doing. He was engaged in racial demagoguery, using code. Would it work? This is 8 years. 8 years. After the political class said we are fundamentally a liberal country, after they announced that the New Deal was essentially consensus politics that would continue into the indefinite future, 8 years later, the New Deal coalition was broken. Lyndon Johnson won 67% of the white vote in 1964. Richard Nixon won 70% of the white vote in 1972. Right. But this is only the first half. This is only the first half of dog whistle politics. This is the half that says you can use race to win votes. What about the other half? This is where the other half really kicks in. Richard Nixon had been, I'm going to say this phrase twice because you don't even recognize this phrase anymore, a liberal Republican. He was a liberal Republican. There used to be such a thing. They actually got destroyed by this shift. The Republican Party itself has been destroyed by dog whistle politics. We can talk about that. In fact, that's what's happening now, by the way. You see every generation of Republicans, the demagoguery that they trade on creates opportunities for themselves to be demagogued by someone stepping further to the right. And what you see is the same shift playing out with Donald Trump. He is destroying yet once more the Republican Party. Okay, we'll get back to that. Ronald Reagan starts his political career as a spokesperson for Barry Goldwater. He understands the power of race in terms of political provocation, but even more, he himself is hostile to activist government, and he's going to combine the two. Now, I start with this photo. Look at how happy he is. Right? The happy warrior. The affect. How could you not vote for this guy? He's like this avuncular happy guy. And why shouldn't he be happy? This is his first official campaign stop after winning the nomination to represent the Republican Party as their candidate in the 1980 campaign. His first official campaign stop. You understand how important this moment is, right? Because this is his first chance to introduce himself to the country and say, I am the official Republican candidate for president. And so where does he go? To Philadelphia, Mississippi, which it turns out is a very small town, right? But it's infamous because 16 years earlier, three civil rights workers had been kidnapped, lynched, their bodies stuffed in an earthen dam and not found for months. Ronald Reagan goes to the Neshoba County Fair in Philadelphia, Mississippi, to start his official campaign for president. And when he goes down there, before a crowd of 10,000 cheering whites, he says, I believe in states' rights. And there wasn't a voter in that crowd who hadn't been alive when these three civil rights workers were killed. This is how he starts his campaign. Okay, this is the sort of racial provocation as vote getting. Okay, how did he transmute racial animosity into the policy preferences of the rich? This is the key. This is the key. How do you take dislike, distrust, resentment of people of color and turn it into billions of dollars for the rich? Okay, he would look out at his audiences. And they were almost uniformly white audiences. Indeed, Nancy Reagan, rest in peace, once said, looking out at his crowd, looking out at a Reagan audience, it's wonderful to see all you beautiful white people. Now, that was a slip, right? Freudian slip. She did not mean to say beautiful. No, sorry. She did not mean to say white. She didn't mean to say white. So she said, excuse me, didn't mean to say it, right? Corrected it. But of course, he's talking to overwhelmingly white audiences. And Reagan would look out at his audience, and he would say, I know how frustrated you are when you're standing in line at the grocery store waiting to buy hamburger and some young buck is ahead of you buying a T-bone steak with food stamps. Now, what's the racial imagery? Y'all know what young buck means, right? So he came under a lot of criticism because this imagery of the strong black man resistant to white authority was too audible. It was too obvious. So he dropped it. And in further renditions, he would say, some young man buying a T-bone steak with food stamps. But the imagery was clear. Who were blacks? Blacks were, they were just lazy. They were strong. They could work. They preferred not to work because they would rather rip off the system, right? They were lazy and larcenous and were living high off of other people's money because of this flaw of who they were temperamentally, right? So this is a story about blacks. It's a story about whites. Because Reagan is saying to a white audience, understand your frustration when you're standing in line to buy hamburger. And the implicit contrast is that if blacks are lazy and larcenous, that whites are decent and law-abiding and hard-working. And because y'all are decent and hard-working and law-abiding, you're struggling to make ends meet. And remember back to that Donald Trump clip that I showed you at the very beginning when he's going to go after Mexicans. But notice how he pauses. He says, who's Mexico sending? And then he says, they're not sending you. They're not sending you. The story of racial fear is always a story, not just of how dangerous and larcenous people of color are, but how good and decent and deserving whites are. Right? It's both, right? It's a very powerful racial story. And yet, the most important character in this story, in the T-bone steak story, who's the most important character? Government. Government. Because Reagan is saying to folks, it's government that is reaching its hands into your pockets, you hardworking, decent, law-abiding, tax-paying folks. Government is reaching its hands into your pocket. It's taking your tax dollars and it's wasting it on these undeserving minorities, right? Or he would say in the law and order theme, it's government that's the real problem because government refuses to defend you from these marauding minorities, right? And it's government that's to blame because government cares more about the criminals than it does about the victims, okay? criminals, victims. You guys got the racial imagery, right? Or the updated version. Government. Hate government because government refuses to secure the southern border. Now, Scott Walker, governor of Wisconsin, who was flamed out very early, he flamed out because he kind of got himself confused, right? Scott Walker was like, hey, we should build a wall on the northern border, too. People looked at him like, are you stupid? This isn't really about illegal immigrants. It's about Mexicans. What the hell's wrong with you, right? But hate government because it's government that refuses to protect you. And then Reagan would say, if government's the problem, what should we do? We should starve it, cut taxes. We should end social programs, these wasteful social programs. Though it turned out under Reagan, the size of government actually grew. Yeah, the social programs got cut, but the subsidies corporations, and in particular to military contractors, went way up, right? And last but not least, if government is the problem, we should trust the marketplace. And so Reagan said, we should deregulate. When in fact, what he meant was, we should let corporations write their own regulations. And these are the policies, right? Cut taxes. The Reagan tax cuts, sorry, just to be clear, the Reagan tax cuts, did they go for the hardworking hamburger-eating folks? The Reagan tax cuts over the 1980s transferred $1 trillion in wealth to the top 1%. And we have never repealed those tax cuts since. Every decade since the 80s, another trillion in wealth to the top 1%. I liberated this slide from Robert Reich. He doesn't mind, or at least he hasn't sued me yet. So this is from his documentary, Inequality for All. Fabulous documentary. Love it. If you haven't seen it, you should see it. What Reich says essentially is there are three policies that drive massive transfers of wealth to the top 1%, right? So what you're looking at is the share of income, and you see it spiking after the roaring 20s, and then you see it collapse suddenly with the sort of Wall Street meltdown, right, of the Great Depression. But then what you see across the 40s, the 50s, and the 60s is governmental policy. Policies of activist government that invest in infrastructure, invest in education, invest in ladders of upward mobility like home ownership and equity, that social security, that help create the biggest expansion of the middle class the world has ever seen. And then right around 1980, something switches, it reverses. And Robert Reich says, what happens? And he says, we started pursuing three policies. Tax cuts for the very rich, massive cuts in social programs that help build the middle class, and allowing corporations to write their own rules, right? These are the three. But what he doesn't explain is why there's so much popular support for those policies. And there's so much popular support for those policies because of the racial story that Reagan uses. Fear people of color. Resent government because it coddles them through welfare and refuses to control them through lax border security, through lax criminal law. Trust instead the marketplace. Today, the top one-tenth of 1% control 22% of the wealth of the country, as much wealth as is controlled by 90% of the rest of us. We got here largely through race. This is the story of dog whistle politics. Okay, I'm going to pause for a second because there's a number of caveats. Let me mention them. Is race the whole story? No, obviously not. This is culture war politics. So part of it is race, part of it is gender, and you could write this story of the dislocations in society as women more and more leave the home, leave traditional families, enter into the workplace. You see it also, in fact, you see it really aggressively now, not just on efforts to politicize and cut back on access to abortion, but even on efforts to restrict access to contraceptions, right? There's a really, and if Hillary Clinton is the nominee, there will be even more aggressive dog whistling around gender, around women who don't know their place, who are disrupting traditional values, who are sacrificing their family life and their children, right? So all of this, so part of it is gender. You know part of this is sexual orientation. All of the campaigning that we've been listening to about the HIV and AIDS panic of the Reagan years, the gay marriage, gay agenda panic, right? All of that, right? This is cultural politics. So gender, sexual orientation, religion, the war on Christmas, the war on Christianity, guns. You need guns to defend yourself against whom? Notice, you need when you look at the spikes in gun sales. The spikes in gun sales have to occur with terrorist attacks and also with the election and re-election of Barack Obama. Right? Who do you have to protect yourself against? You have to protect yourself against people of color, and you have to protect yourself against government. Because government not only won't protect you, government, because it coddles minorities, is actually going to come and take your guns. Right? This is culture war politics, so it's all of these. All right. Is this all then culture war politics? No. There's other things going on. One thing, for instance, the basic conservative message is distrust government. Distrust government. Now, coming in the wake of Watergate and in the wake of Vietnam, the distrust government message resonated with a lot of people. Coming in the wake of the 80s and even more in the wake of the sort of Gingrich revolution of the 90s, the distrust government message made even more sense because the conservatives were busy gumming up the works of government. They were making it a point to make government fail. Right? And so all of this sort of, and now I should say, why should we distrust government? Because, to be frank, most of government, including the Democratic Party, is in the hands of big business. Right? So if the theme is distrust government, that actually resonates with a lot of people, irrespective of its connection with race. Okay. Or is this the full story? No. In any given electoral cycle, there'll be other things going on. Maybe it's Iran-Contra. Maybe Russ Perot is running. In any given electoral cycle, right, there's going to be a lot of noise. But what I want to point out is two things. One, the power of that graph. Right? This is increasing patterns of wealth concentration. And let's be clear, you see that dip after 2007. That was the Great Recession. But you all know that 95% of the recovery since then has gone to the top 1%. And levels of wealth income inequality are right back up. They're higher than they were in 1928 today. Right? So one is the power of the graph. Here's the other thing. I want to remind you, Lyndon Johnson was the last Democrat to win a majority of the white vote in 1964. Right? There is a sea change that occurs. Now it's not linear, right? It goes up and down. But today, the Republican Party, 98% of its elected officials are white. And the party draws its support, here's the official statistic, the party draws its support, 89% of its support comes from whites, 6% comes from Hispanics, and the remainder from blacks and Asians. But I want to just pause there for a second. You may or may not know that among Latinos, there's a split, and more or less half of Latinos think they're white. And there's good social science showing that lighter-skinned Latinos are much more likely to vote Republican. In other words, I don't think it's a stretch to say the Republican Party today draws 93 or 94% of its support from whites. That includes Hispanics who think they're white, but from whites. In other words, the GOP today, they are that white man's party. They are that white man's party. This is whiter than most country clubs. Right? It's hard to find a country club that is 93, 94% white, and that its officers are 90%. And yet the GOP, this is what they've done. And I want to say the problem isn't that there's so many whites there. The problem is that they have organized themselves around whiteness. They have organized themselves around a narrative of racial fear and racial resentment tied to a set of policies which really help the very rich. That's where we are. Okay, or at least that's where we were in the 80s. Three big shifts since then. Here's shift number one. That says Clinton Gore, 1992. I couldn't stand it. I just had to cut it off. Okay. Here's the shift that's happening. Democrats, how are they going to respond? How are they going to respond? So I told you, in 1970, they could see that race could be used as a wedge issue against them. And they said to themselves, we got to stay silent. Because this is sort of a grassroots prairie fire. We just got to let itself burn itself out. So we're going to stay silent. We're going to stop talking about race. We're going to back away from race a little bit. By 1992, it was clear that wasn't working. Right? Okay. So here's another approach.
They're a new generation of Democrats, Bill Clinton and Al Gore, and they don't think the way the old Democratic Party did. They've called for an end to welfare as we know it, so welfare can be a second chance, not a way of life. They've sent a strong signal to criminals by supporting the death penalty. And they've rejected the old tax and spend politics. Clinton's balanced 12 budgets, and they've proposed a new plan investing in people, detailing $140 billion in spending cuts they'd make right now. Clinton Gore, for people, for a change.
End welfare as a way of life? Well, for whom is it a way of life? Crack down on criminals? And this is Bill Clinton, who went out of his way to travel back to Arkansas during the 1992 campaign season to make sure he was there to supervise the election of a mentally impaired black man. Right. Well, who are these criminals we're cracking down on?
Electrocution.
Electrocution.
Not the election.
I'm sorry.
The electrocution.
Electrocution. Right. Yeah. Did I say the election?
Yes.
Yeah, a little bit. Key to the story. He was elected to hire. And then this attack on federal government. What you see here, and this is crucial, is Democrats with Bill Clinton decide that in order to compete with Republicans, they have to adopt the same frames. And so Bill Clinton actually does much more damage in terms of driving us towards mass incarceration. Right, with the three strikes laws and whatnot, does much more. Indeed, Michelle Alexander says it's Clinton much more than Reagan that helps build up the massive carceral system we stagger under today. Right? And it's Clinton much more than Reagan who is more successful in terms of dismantling social welfare programs. Right? Democrats begin to compete with Republicans to show who can be tougher on people of color. Right? And so this is an enormously consequential shift. Let me just say one other thing. A lot of progressives who aren't thinking about race look at Bill Clinton and say this is the period where the Democratic Party starts to invite Wall Street in, right, and begins to support NAFTA and all of these and the deregulation of Wall Street and whatnot. Yeah, and it's connected to race. These new Democrats felt like they had to walk away from minorities, but they also felt like they had to walk away from liberalism, because liberalism was associated with helping people of color. And they walk away from both and end up embracing Wall Street. And so a lot of the pattern that I'm showing you, it's clear, the political science on this is pretty clear, middle class does slightly better under Democrats than it does under Republicans, but only slightly. And in fact, that main trajectory of increasing wealth inequality, of increasing wealth being transferred to the very rich, that proceeds under Bill Clinton and, frankly, proceeds under Barack Obama as well. Right? So the Democratic Party has largely shifted its alliance away from people of color, away from workers, and towards Wall Street. And it really starts here. Next big change. This is Professor Robert Perry.
This president, I will suggest, is totally and absolutely either inept or making some decisions that are not in the best interest of American citizens, particularly from a public safety standpoint. We flagged this issue in 2012 and have yet to even have a response, as far as I know, from the president, but not even from his administration. We have record high numbers of other than Mexicans being apprehended at the border. These are people that are coming from states like Syria that have substantial connections back to terrorist regimes and terrorist operations. So, I mean, I think whether you're a Democrat or Republican,
absolutely,
you need to be addressing this, Mr. President, and putting, we know how to do this. We have surged into sectors of the border and shut down the illegal activities that are going on there, but we don't have the resources nor the...
Okay, enough for Rick Perry. We'll get to Romney in a second. Here's the deal. Dog whistling starts with African Americans. It starts with African Americans as the boogeyman, demonize African Americans, demonize blacks, welfare queen, all that imagery. But after 9/11, the racial rhetoric shifts in a highly consequential direction. 9/11 allows the creation of an Arab-Muslim boogeyman. And the Arab-Muslim boogeyman, sometimes the language is religion, sometimes the language is region, but the conflation is always centered in the with the face of Osama bin Laden in the background. It's a racialized sort of rhetoric that conflates all of the different actors in the Middle East. And indeed, it's this sort of rhetoric that George Bush uses when he talks about a clash of civilization, that he uses when he sells the country the idea that we should go to war in Iraq, as if Iraq had anything to do with the 9/11 hijackers who were overwhelmingly from Saudi Arabia, right? But it's not just that this image of the Muslim extremist or terrorist is a way to shift U.S. foreign policy. Even more, it's couched as an internal threat. And this is why you have, you know, things like Kansas passing laws that prohibit Sharia law. But Kansas passed a law that prohibits its courts from drawing on the Quran when they interpret Kansas law, because apparently it was a huge problem. They just had to nip it in the bud. Right? It's insanity. But the imagery is not just external threat, but internal threat, that the country is being penetrated by these Arab Muslim extremists. We don't know who they are. We can't trust them no matter who they are. Right? And this is part of the imagery that is then read on to Barack Obama, or, as Fox and Friends like sometimes to say, Barack Hussein Obama. To read on to him this sense, not just of foreignness, but of a dangerous, racially threatening other. Right? Now, what happens is, as the rhetoric of these dark brown foreign others coming into our midst and threatening our civilization generate, they easily metastasize to incorporate Latinos. There had always been, regionally, in California, for example, a politics around illegal aliens as a way of talking about undocumented immigrants. But it had been regional. It was Texas, California. After 9/11, it goes national. So that you have states like New Hampshire, in which people are campaigning about sealing the southern border. And you're like, you guys are okay. Think about the Republican debate that you just heard in New Hampshire. Not the part where they're asking about immigration, which is all about building a beautiful wall, but the part about what problems you see in New Hampshire. And Donald Trump says, I see drugs, I see heroin, and this is terrible because it's Mexicans who are bringing it in. It's all coming from Mexico. Right? And somehow, right, everything is getting tied down to Mexico, even in New Hampshire. So this is a major change in our rhetoric. And I would say in 2016, watch for dog whistle politics around Muslims and around Mexicans, not so much around African Americans. Although, after the violence in Chicago, you see the language of thug now, that now Trump is starting to use that language, right? I think there's going to be, we can talk about the violence in Chicago. Okay, we got to get to Mitt Romney. Third big change, right? So second big change is these other racial characters, it's blacks, it's Mexicans, it's Muslims. Third big change. Mitt Romney is going to campaign in 2012 on like traditional dog whistle themes. He's going to spend half his advertising budget trying to falsely tie Barack Obama to welfare. Okay, and PolitiFact is going to give him a pants on fire rating, and Mitt Romney's campaign is going to respond by saying, we won't let our campaign be dictated by the facts. Now, I love that. That was my second favorite moment. This is my favorite moment. Right now, this video is going to surface, showing Romney speaking to donors at a sort of major fundraising campaign. You all have heard this video before, but why I want you to listen to it again with the lens of dog whistle politics. Listen to the language he uses.
There are 47% of the people who vote for the president no matter what. All right, there are 47% who are with him, who are dependent upon government, who believe that they are victims, who believe that government has a responsibility to care for them, who believe that they are entitled to health care, to food, to housing, to you name it. But that's an entitlement, and the government should give it to them. And they will vote for this president no matter what. And so my job is not to worry about those people. I'll never convince them. They should take personal responsibility and care for their lives. What I have to do is convince the 5 to 10% in the Senate.
Okay. He's not talking about people of color anymore. And so in that sense, it can't be dog whistle politics. He's talking about 47% of the country. Now, just to be clear, that 47% figure is coming out of a study saying that 47% of Americans don't pay federal income tax. What he's not saying is that among that 47% who don't pay federal income tax, they pay sales tax, they pay property tax, they pay Social Security. The average tax burden for people who do not pay income tax, federal income tax, still 14%. Slightly higher than what Mitt Romney himself was paying. That lying SOB. Because what he's saying is, hey, there's makers and there's takers. And the people who don't pay 47, don't pay income tax at 47%, they're the takers. But listen to that language. They're dependent on government. They have an entitlement mentality. They refuse to take responsibility for themselves, right? That is the kind of rhetoric that we last heard in this country 100 years ago. That's the kind of rhetoric that was driven out of political discourse during the New Deal. And I want you to think back just a moment. Think back to that Lyndon Johnson ad that I showed you that was talking about ending poverty. What color were the faces of poverty? They were white. Lyndon Johnson was using white faces because the country as a whole, New Deal was set up in a way that was racially discriminatory. It was the price of support from Southern Democrats that the New Deal programs be arranged in a way that they were either formally racially restrictive or could be administered in a racially restrictive way, right? And so the New Deal gained support among whites when people have a sense that helping people who are poor is helping people who are like themselves, who are decent, who are hardworking, who may be down on their luck, who need a helping hand up, and who will soon be back on their feet and contributing. This language of the people who are poor as having an entitlement mentality, as refusing to take care of themselves, of people not being responsible, people rejected that language. They rejected that language in endorsing activist government, endorsing the New Deal. And yet it came back into our political discourse applied to blacks. It came back as a way to say what was wrong with black welfare queens, black welfare recipients. And now what you're seeing in 2012 is that language doesn't just apply to blacks, doesn't just apply to Latinos and Muslims, it applies to whites too. For the Republican Party, it has developed a rhetoric that says we don't need to care about half the country because y'all have an entitlement mentality and refuse to take responsibility for yourselves, right? And that rhetoric was sold initially to the country through stories of blacks on welfare, but now it applies to half the country. Okay. So one question. Disastrous, right? How did Mitt Romney do? He lost. We're clear? He lost, right? So that was the good news. How did he do among whites? This is a candidate who is saying to the country, I don't give a crap about half of y'all because you've refused to take responsibility for yourselves. You have an entitlement mentality. I don't care. And in terms of what he's saying affirmatively, in terms of his policies, remember what his policies were? Tax cuts for the rich, slash the size of government, especially with Paul Ryan as a running mate, get government out of the way of corporations. Okay, so you have a candidate who is saying, I'm going to pursue the policies that are very good for the very rich, and I don't care about half of you. And he wins 3 out of 5 white votes. And he doesn't win. So right after his election, day after his election, New York Times has an article, analysis, and it quotes a Republican operative who says, there just aren't enough old white men to win anymore. This is not a story of old white men, right? And this isn't a story of the South. This isn't the Southern strategy. This is a national strategy. Mitt Romney wins among whites all across the country. He wins among men, but he wins among women. And he wins among every age cohort of whites, even 18 to 24-year-olds. This is dog whistle politics. 59% of the white vote. The only two Republicans who've done notably better are Richard Nixon in 72 and Ronald Reagan in his re-election in 84. Right. This is not a story of the declining power of race. This is a story of race actually recently increasing in power. Mitt Romney won 59% of the white vote. If he'd won 62% of the white vote, he would have carried the popular vote nationally. In 2014, in the midterm elections, Republicans running for Congress won 62% of the white vote. This is the map, this is the rhetoric that Donald Trump is looking at. He sees that it works, right? And he's seized on it. Before we get to Donald Trump, I'll come back to Donald Trump in a second, but we might as well familiarize ourselves with his alternative.
There's a scorpion in the desert. For most of us, its venom is a clear and deadly threat. But others refuse to even speak its name. Since the scorpion seeks our destruction, isn't it time we recognize the scorpion for what it is? Before it strikes again.
I'm Ted Cruz, and I approve this message.
Now, obviously, he's not getting the scorpion vote. I'm just telling you right now. Doesn't matter what the danger is. Maybe it's Mexicans, maybe it's ISIS, maybe it's Ebola crossing the southern border. It doesn't matter. What matters is the message, threat, they mean our destruction, vote for me in my ostrich skin boots. Right? Okay. All right. Okay. Back to this gentleman. Is this still dog whistle politics, or has Trump gone someplace else? Has he dropped the whistle for a trumpet? Couldn't resist. Yes and no. Dog whistling speaks in code, and it speaks in code because it wants to hide racism from two audiences. One are the critics, and the other are the people that it mobilizes themselves. Okay? I think that what Trump has recognized is he doesn't have to hide his bias, his bigotry, his racial manipulation from the critics. It doesn't matter to him. Indeed, it helps him if the New York Times or the Washington Post or people like me say this is a race-baiting demagogue. Right? Because what that does is it allows Trump to play into a couple of dynamics. One dynamic is actually doesn't have to do with race so much as who the elite is in this country. In terms of dog whistle politics, the elite are not the financial elite, they're the cultural elite. The bi-coastal cultural elite of Hollywood, of San Francisco, of Berkeley, of New York. And the message in this sort of refrain is to working class whites, working class and middle class whites, you are being betrayed by the elite who condescend to you, who disdain you. You really need the support of us populace, right? And so this helps because Trump can say, I'm being attacked by the Washington Post, I'm being attacked by the New York Times. He has not yet noticed that he's being attacked by Ian Haney López, but he will. I'm catching up with him. And when he does, it's going to help him with his audience, right? Because it's elite. But the other thing that's going on is today, roughly 70% of whites think that racism against whites is as big a problem as racism against non-whites. And what are people thinking when they say that? They're thinking affirmative action, and they're thinking unjustified accusations of racism. So what's happening is Donald Trump gets to say, hey, I'm being accused of being a racist, and that's just more evidence of the way in which whites are attacked all the time, are discriminated all the time, including by these unsubstantiated, unacceptable accusations that we're racist, right? Or one of the earlier dog whistlers, George Wallace used to say, the biggest bigots in the world are those who accuse others of being bigots. You just flip it around, right? And so if you say to Donald Trump, you're being racist, he turns it around and says, actually, you're being racist by accusing me of being racist, and that makes me the victim, right? So I think what he's realized is it doesn't matter if the critics see the race baiting. In fact, it kind of helps him. But, and I really want to emphasize this point, it's still very important that most of his followers do not see the racial manipulation. Okay. He's still hiding his racism from most of his followers. Now, not the white nationalists, not the white supremacists, Stormfront, they're pretty clear on what's being said, right? So the David Duke, the Klan, they're pretty clear that this is about protecting the interests of whites. They're coming out and endorsing him. But that's not who most of his supporters are. Most of his supporters are not white nationalists. They do not regularly get their news from Stormfront. They are not David Duke fans. They don't have those goofy pointy hats, right? That's not who most of his supporters are. Most of his supporters are good, decent folks who are stressed about the economy and about the changing face of the country. And both of those anxieties are real, they're profound, and Trump is speaking to those fears in a way that hides even from most of his supporters that these fears are really, at least the demographic ones, are really rooted first and foremost in ugly racial stereotypes, right? And this is why, and this is where Trump almost got it wrong and had to adjust very quickly. Here's the rule. He cannot use a racial epithet, right? Can't use a racial epithet, can't say the N-word, can't say spick, right? Can't use a racial epithet, can never say the word white, right? Because then it's clear that he's talking about race. Must denounce the Klan quickly, right? That's the one he got wrong. He thought he could kind of like flirt with the Klan a little bit. It's like, no, it's important to his supporters that they are supporting somebody that they know actually repudiates the Klan. This actually connects with Ben Carson, right? Ben Carson is a black candidate, this low energy, mumbling, right? But what he was doing was he was saying to people with his calm demeanor, A, I'm not an angry black man. B, I was dysfunctional as a kid because I was like taking a knife and trying to stab people, but Christianity saved me. C, Obama and Obamacare is the next worst thing since slavery, or worse than slavery, right? He was good in the racial rhetoric, and it allowed Ben Carson supporters to say to themselves, I can't possibly be a racist because I support a black man who tells me this country is going to hell because of black people. Right, but I'm not a racist. And now Carson, of course, has endorsed Donald Trump. Okay, so this is what I think is happening in terms of dog whistle politics. To the critics, it seems so blatant. But I think it's really important to understand we are not a nation of hate every black and brown and Muslim person. Right? That's not who a third of us are or whatever, right? These are real fears, the economic fears, the demographic fears. We have to take them seriously and not think we're just dealing with a whole bunch of bigots who support this race baiter, right? That is, I think that's a big mistake. Okay, I'm going to wrap up really quickly here with my basic point, and then some suggestions about what we can do. Basic point. We think of race as what's happening with people of color. And what I'm trying to stress is that race and economic inequality and government are all tied together. And I really want to stress this for progressives. I don't care who you are or what issue you care about as a progressive. And it could be, connected with people of color, like schooling or like immigration or like prisons. It could be completely disconnected, you might think, like campaign finance reform or infrastructure or healing the environment. I don't care what issue you care about. In a complex society like ours, you're going to need government on the side of the people and not the corporations. You just need government help. And in that context, the biggest weapon against popular support for activist government is race. And so I really want to stress that this connection between race and wealth inequality and government. Okay. What can we do? Speak out. Name and shame. It turns out that the best antidote to dog whistling is to call it out for what it is. Recognizing that you'll get a lot of pushback, recognizing that when you say to Donald Trump and his supporters, hey, this is really racial fear mongering, they'll turn around and say, well, you're the real racist. Just say at that point, listen, whoever pulls a fire alarm didn't necessarily set the fire. Right? And whoever calls the police, whoever dials 911 didn't necessarily commit the crime. Saying that race is a problem doesn't mean you're a racist. Right? Say, and this is all you have to say, I just want you to think about whether this is racial panic or not. And don't bother trying to convince them because that's just going to be a brutal conversation. But it's enough. The social psychological studies are really interesting. It's enough to force people to think consciously about whether they're being manipulated by race. Right? And to just leave it at that, you don't have to fight the whole battle, speak out. Notice that you have to speak out about colorblindness. Why colorblindness? Because it's colorblindness that dog whistle politicians are drawing on. It's colorblindness that says it's not race unless you use the racial epithet or otherwise mention race expressly. And this is what allows Donald Trump and Ted Cruz and all these other people to say, hey, I was just talking about scorpions. I can't possibly be talking about race, right? That's colorblindness. It says it's only race if you use an epithet or mention race expressly. But it's colorblindness that also says, but if you do mention race expressly, whether for a remedial purpose or not, that's racism. And that's that second step of colorblindness that allows Trump, Cruz, all these guys to turn around and say, well, you know who mentions race all the time? Liberals. And that's because liberals are always trying to divide us by race by talking about race. Liberals should stop talking about race. And allow us conservatives to keep talking about race in code, right? And so we have to recognize how colorblindness works and say, that is not true. Racism can be expressed in race-neutral language, and talking about race is often the best antidote to racism, not itself racism. Okay, so that's one. Two. Address these anxieties. So what happens with a lot of Democrats is a couple of things. They say, listen, race is divisive, so let's not talk about it. Let's just talk about class. And because we're liberals and we're touchy-feely and we want to be positive, let's have an aspirational message about how if we all just get together, we're all going to be fine and things are going to be great. Right? And I say two things. One, resentment abhors a vacuum. People need to know who to blame. Who did this? Who's responsible? The economic anxiety is real. We've got to identify that anxiety and identify the culprits. We've got to say, okay, Bernie, you've got to say, this is being done by the corporations. This is what happens when you hand your country over to the very rich. This is what happens when you allow mega businesses to write their own rules, right? I mean, you have to say that. You have to identify the source of the anxiety and the actual culprits. Two, progressives don't want to talk about race, and that's a tremendous mistake, or other status anxieties. This is a post-civil rights phenomena. What is the civil rights movement? The civil rights movement of the 1960s was the moment when this country, which, let's be clear, was founded on white supremacy, from slavery to the dispossession of Native Americans, to westward expansion, to manifest destiny, to an empire that stretched across the Caribbean into the Pacific. It was founded on an ideal of white supremacy. That's what it was. But in the 1960s, we as a country began the process of repudiating that foundational notion. Right? And we made great strides. For example, we drove out of public discourse any sort of express defense of white supremacy. But in response to that effort, there's been a tremendous amount of pushback. Now, we didn't just try and end white supremacy. We tried to end sort of sexism, right? We tried to end patriarchy of men over women. We tried to end homophobia. We tried to integrate in terms of Native Americans. There's so many different social movements in the 1960s, in the 1970s. And all of those have created both great social progress and great social insecurity. And we've got to address those insecurities, because those are the very insecurities that the right has been preying upon. The right has been telling people, you are being disrespected as a white person, as a man, as a husband, as a father, as a worker, as a Christian, as straight, right? You're being disrespected, your position's being undercut. And we need to respond to that, not just understanding that that is what's happening, but recognizing, and here I want to be optimistic, recognizing that people do want to feel good about themselves, but that people can feel good about themselves if we give people a positive sense of what it means to be American, to be in this together, to really be part of a we that embraces everybody and that refuses to be divided by fear and resentment. And so that's an incredible project for the left, is to say we need a conceptualization of a new we, not a fragmented we. And this goes back to the sort of McGovern years. A lot of people talk about the Democratic Party as the party of all these different minority special interests. I think that language is an enormous mistake. I think we need to talk about a new progressive movement of the sort of the new American majority, which is radically inclusive. And this is not something we can do today or tomorrow. This is a project for the next 5 or 10 years. But we need to understand it is absolutely essential that we give everybody in this country a way to be proud of who they are and what they contribute when they see themselves in each other and refuse to be divided against each other, against other working people. Okay. Integrate. I mean integrate in two senses. I mean integrate in the sense of putting race and economics together, not trying to solve racism to the exclusion of class and inequality, and certainly not trying to solve inequality to the exclusion of race. We've got to work on both together. And I also mean integration in that historic sense, right? I might as well talk about Tulane for a second. This is not a super well-integrated environment. To the extent that it's not integrated, it allows whites to feel that they have something to defend, that there are privileges that they have access to, and this may be consciously, more likely subconsciously, but allows whites to feel like they have privileges that they must defend. And it allows people of color to say, they have no idea what my issues are. there is no basis for commonality, because our worlds never meet. If we don't integrate our society, we will remain susceptible to this sort of divide and conquer politics, and we will continue to fall victim to it, because people will be saying to themselves, either I have something to defend, or I have nothing in common with those folks. They're actually, they've reserved the best for themselves, and we can't make common cause. We must integrate our society. This is my last slide, my last recommendation. This is not going to happen this year. This is not going to happen in this electoral cycle, though I want to say, for me, this is a moment of profound pessimism to see the sort of violence and the wild, enthusiastic support of Donald Trump, but also a moment of profound optimism. I don't think anybody has forced to the surface so clearly this festering wound of racial fear and resentment that we have been poisoned by for the last 50 years as Donald Trump. And it creates a moment of reckoning where if we can stop dismissing Trump as this demagogue, outlier, never seen him before, and start saying he's symptomatic of what we've been doing, it creates a moment of reckoning for us as a society to say, good God, what have we done? We have wrecked the middle class out of racial fear and racial resentment. We have given over our society to the 0.1%, and it's going to require a huge fight to get it back. Right, but I think that there's this moment here where we can have that conversation, that we can mobilize for that fight. I don't want to leave you with the sort of mobilize for this giant fight as if it's like, okay, I'm out. You know, see you guys, go get them. So let me make it a little bit more practical. There's lots of different movements that you all have access to. And it can be a movement around immigration. It can be a movement around mass incarceration, the environment, humane society. I don't care what movement it is. These movements, join them, participate in them, link them together. And the link is to have people in all these different movements saying, we need government back on the side of all of us. And what's keeping that from happening is a politics that stresses that we fear and resent each other. We can get government back to help everybody, to help all of these different movements. The moment we say that we are not fearful of each other, but that we are for each other, right? And that's what's going to link these movements. That's how you can mobilize. That's where I'm going to end. Thank you all so very much.
He's given us so much of his time and spoken for so long. I'm just going to take maybe a few questions because his voice has got to be killing him. But how about some questions? Yes, sir.
Yeah, I have a question in line with what your comments were. And it is that the Democratic candidates generally favor increasing the minimum wage, which generally is good for everybody, particularly the whites as well as blacks. But yet you still can't bring the whites along, the white, you know, working class population. Why would they vote against their own best interests?
That question, the sort of own best interest, is really perplexing if you think about interests solely in economic terms. Right, and then you can't see it. Why vote? And it's not just minimum wage. Think about Medicare expansion under Obamacare, right? Under the Affordable Care Act, all across the South, you have politicians who refuse to expand Medicare, even though federal government would pay for all of it. This leaves this sort of large segment of primarily white working class folks uninsured. Why? It doesn't make any sense. It starts to make more sense when you shift over and understand that self-interest also has a strong racial component. Who do they feel they are? Do they feel they're respected? What's the biggest threat in their lives? And so I'm from California. I grew up in Hawaii. I can't claim to know the South the way you all know it, but I do know that about 90% of whites are voting Republican. And that is an astounding, astounding number, given that that's the number of folks who are voting for politicians who are essentially destroying the working class and the middle class, right? And what is it? And you know, there's been some very compelling studies showing, even within the South, those portions of the South where whites are most likely to vote Republican are those portions of the South which had the most intense usages of slavery in the 1840s through the 1860s, right? What's happening in modern American politics is deeply, deeply connected to racial fear. And we're not going to get anywhere until we surface that connection and make it explicit and say to whites, your fate, the fate of your children, depends upon you recognizing the damage that racism does. That you might think that racism is somehow giving you a sort of a sense of prestige and position, but in fact, all you've done is you've handed over the country to the mega rich. And let me just say one more comment. The mega rich are not white. And what I mean by that is, sure, they're white in terms of European descent or whatever, but they're not functionally white in the sense of they really care about white people and that's their primary allegiance. They don't. Right, they're busy exporting all of these jobs and offshoring their profits and refusing to repatriate money in terms of taxes. The mega rich are transnational. And this is the biggest, most important difference between the rich of today and the rich of 1928. The rich of 1928, their market was the United States, and what happened to us mattered to them. That is no longer true of the rich today. And so it's the greatest sort of racial fraud ever, where you have working and middle class whites who are essentially voting their racial fear to support an elite group who have no allegiance to this country. Right? And that's the tough conversation. And let me just say, that's the conversation that we're not really hearing. That even when you listen to Bernie Sanders or Hillary Clinton, what they're saying is, one, a conversation about class. Two, a conversation that says, and we should also care about mass incarceration and immigration. But no one yet on the Democratic side is standing up and saying, you know what happened to us as a party? You know what happened to us as a country? Many whites defected because they thought that we didn't represent their interests as whites. And we need to have a hard conversation about that.
Race and economics are at bottom explanatory of a lot of what's happened, that coupled with Nixon's Southern strategy in 68. So if we scroll it back to the preceding 4 years, it strikes me as somewhat ironic that much of what happened in 68 may have been attributable to iconic expressions of a liberal society. The War on Poverty, Voting Rights Act, which LBJ said cost the Democrats the South for generations, proving longer than that.
Right.
Other examples, enforcement of Brown finally getting traction in the 1960s.
Right.
So political strategy unlocked Pandora's box and inflicted this nightmare of the last 50 years on us. You've suggested the beginnings of a political strategy that might reverse that. Is there a political opportunity that in the near term will liberate us from this, or do we have to rely on mortality to extract the worst elements?
That's a great question. I really want to pick up on that. The mortality point is actually the current Democratic strategy. We should be clear, right? So Democrats are running around and some sort of Democratic pollsters are running around saying there is a demographic sea change at hand. Every year there is another 12,000 Latino voters or whatever the number is, right? And don't worry, whites will soon be a minority and then we'll get past this. So, a couple of quibbles. How do you think whites react when the Democrats say, don't worry, you'll soon be a minority and then the world will be a better place, right? And the studies are quite clear. When whites focus on demographic change, they increase in their levels of racial anxiety and political conservatism. Okay? Here's the other fact, though. Here's the other quibble. these numbers, this demographic change, really depend on not counting Hispanics as white. Okay, so the Census Bureau tells us that whites will be a minority of the country by 2043. Whites right now are 62% of the country, minority by 2043. Unless you include Latinos. Half of Latinos, roughly half of Latinos, think they're white. When the Census Bureau includes them, then in 2043, whites will be 72% of the country. I do not think that we are in a period in which whites are becoming a minority. I think we're in a period in which whites are gaining numerically because the white category is expanding. And let me just be clear, there are a lot of conservatives who want to expand the white category. Because again, they're not actually bigots. You know, it's like this I should put a name on. This is Karl Rove. Karl Rove, maybe he's a bigot. I don't know. But more than anything else, he's a strategist. And he knows that if he can expand the boundaries of whiteness, they can keep dog whistling for the next 20, 30 years. Now the dog whistles have to shift, right? But George W. Bush won 44% of the Latino vote in 2004. GOP understands that they need to win roughly 40 to 42% of the Latino vote to take the White House. Those numbers are well within their reach. And let me just say about Latinos, and so this is just this incredibly important conversation that needs to happen within Latino communities, within East Asian communities, within African-American communities too. There's this expanding, more capacious understanding of race that says, if you're educated, if you're upper class, if you're light-skinned, if you have an anglicized name, if you speak without an accent, you can be given a sort of a functional white identity, so long as you subscribe to a bunch of norms that essentially support whiteness, right? And let me, this is really important. This is a story not of whites, meaning blue-eyed, European descent. No, I don't care about that. This is a story about whiteness. And whiteness is an ideology that says some people are worth more, some people are decent and caring and deserving, and some people are dangerous and dark and threatening. And it doesn't really matter where you draw the line, as long as you believe in the story that some people are deserving and some people aren't. And let me tell you, there's a lot of Latinos who believe that story, who resent more recent arrivals, who resent people who are darker, who resent people who speak English with an accent for dragging our group down. Same thing is happening within East Asian and South Asian communities. Same thing is happening, though to a lesser degree, in African American communities, because I think because of the sort of polar position that African Americans occupy, but still there's this dynamic, right? What we are fighting is this belief in whiteness. And we have to fight it in the nominally white community, but we have to fight it in nominally non-white communities too, because there's going to be an invitation to participate in whiteness. And I fear we have a long history of people accepting that invitation.
I think what I'd like to do is I want to make sure you all don't leave before getting the opportunity to get the bargain basement price of $10 on his book.
Which gives you a sense of how well it's selling. We're just giving it away at this point. This is a remainder book.
He's very generous to let us do this. And so Professor Ian Haney López is going to be sitting out there signing books, and you can ask him more questions because there are many that come out of this. But let's thank him.
Thank you all.